I will tell you about ptarmigan hunting in north of Norway, from planning to dinner. Ptarmigan hunting is the number one recreational hunting activity in Norway. Almost 350,000 hunters that hunt every year. This picture is a picture of my friend Erling, which just shot two ptarmigans. And we are on a mountain just 30 minutes from the city of Tromsø. Well, maybe 40 minutes from the city of Tromsø, which is, well, in North Norwegian scale, it's a big city, 70,000 inhabitants. But as you can see, the nature around Tromsø on this beautiful day is packed with mountains. And on all these mountains, you will find this mountain bird, ptarmigan. We'll tell you more about that, of course. The reason for this hunting being so popular is we are hunting not only on days like this, but also on bad weather days. It's a nice way to get out in the nature. You have a goal. You want to hunt. It's exciting. You want to get food to the table, and at the same time, you have a very nice experience in the nature. And you are tired and relaxed when you get home. It's not only men that hunt ptarmigans in Norway. It's more and more women that do this, and also young people. So the tradition is absolutely being kept up and is warm. But we have some challenges that I will tell you more about today. First, tell you a little bit about ptarmigans. In Norway, we have two types or two species. We have the rock ptarmigan, Lagopus muta, with several subspecies, and we have also the willow ptarmigan. The rock ptarmigan, as you can see on this picture, is dispersed actually almost all over the world in the northern areas. You have some populations in the Alps also, some localized populations, always in high mountains. You have rock ptarmigans in Iceland, on the sides of Greenland, where you don't have inland ice, and where rocks and vegetation is exposed. They are dispersed pretty much all over the northern hemisphere, and lives from approximately 400 meters and upwards. The bird here seen with a male in spring, because it has a red comb over the eye, which is a secondary sexual characteristics, and the female are gray during the spring and summer, and white during the winter. And you can see that typical ptarmigan has a pretty big trunk-like body with short legs, and also a pretty short neck. And the reason for this is that, of course, the bird is covered in very well insulated feathers. And when you have this trunk-like body with small appendages, legs and neck, you keep the heat inside the bird in a very good fashion, because the surface area related to the volume is small. So that meaning that it's a long way for the heat from inside the bird to get out, so it's a little bit chubby, and that's to keep the heat inside. Then you have the willow ptarmigan, which is brown because it lives further down, maybe from 50 meters above the sea level until 300-400 meters, and the camouflage is then designed forest and other types of vegetation, not so many rocks. Lagopus, and the lagopus is a Latin word that refers to the legs, which is very hairy, means hairy leg, and of course the legs are hairy because they need to insulate, so it's a lot of feathers. I will show you a better picture. The willow ptarmigan is also pretty much dispersed in the northern hemisphere. As you can see, they are not situated in the Alps or in other high mountains further south, because that's more for the rock ptarmigan. You have also several subspecies here. You have the grouse, which is a subspecies living in Scotland, and it's a little bit bigger bird. So they have small individual differences, but they can mate with each other, and they can get offspring that also can have offspring. This is a picture of the willow ptarmigan. And in this picture you can see, which is also taken in spring, you can see the red combs over the eyes for the to attract the female. And so this guy is ready to mate. And you can see on the feet that they have a lot of hairs on the feet to insulate. If you look at the rock ptarmigan, in a typical environment for this bird, high up in the mountain, the rock ptarmigan has a black band through the eyes, and this is in winter, so it's completely white. And also here you have feathers, of course, on the legs. The rock ptarmigan is a little bit smaller than the willow ptarmigan. And that's a little bit more trunk-like because it needs to conserve the heat a little bit better. The diet of the ptarmigan, they eat a lot of different vegetation, and they are herbivorous, meaning that except that they eat also, of course, insects, but that's mostly important in when they are chicks. The type of food they eat during winter is very low in energy, so they need to eat very much, because this diet during winter is low in energy. They need to digest it for a long time, meaning that they need to eat a lot and have the digestive system full of food at all times. Actually, in one ptarmigan. This is willow ptarmigan. In one ptarmigan like this, it was measured 2 meters of small pieces of this vegetation in the stomach, 2 meters put together. The digestive system of the ptarmigan is, similar to other birds, of course, or a lot of other birds. They have an esophagus that brings the food down to the crop. And the crop is a sac that stores the food temporarily, so it could fill it up to, for instance, if the ptarmigan is in the area where the vegetation is good and there's a lot of it, it could fill up the crop with more food after the stomach is full. So the food continues down to the gizzard, or the muscular stomach, where the vegetation, the plants are grinded with a very strong muscular contractions of the stomach. And also the bird eats small rocks to help the grinding of the plants. When this is in a broken down to like a soup, it's going further down in the small intestine, and very importantly for the ptarmigan, ends up in the sacheum on this side and on this side. In the sacheum, you have a lot of bacteria and one-celled organisms that eat or digest the plants for the bird. Yeah, so the bacteria and the protozoa and other one-celled organisms, they digest the plants and they produce small, short, fatty acids that is taken up by the blood and which is actually the energy for the bird. So it's actually waste products from the bacterial decomposition of the plants, which is the energy for the bird. Small, free fatty acids, which is produced from the digestion. So the cecum is very important for the bird. Then the leftovers goes out, of course. This picture shows you the feces of the willow ptarmigan to the left and the rock ptarmigan to the right. The willow ptarmigan has a little bit different diet, so that the feces is light brown, while the diet of the rock ptarmigan produces more dark feces. And this is typical when we hunt. We look for these signs to see, for instance, okay, there has been some ptarmigans here, and how long it has been since they were here. And also, since the rock ptarmigan is a little bit smaller bird, the feces is also a little bit smaller. Which is interesting in this picture to the left is this loose feces, which is actually when the bird empties the cecum. They have to empty these blind sacs once in a while to get rid of old material, which is non-decomposable, and maybe change a little bit, get out the dead bacteria and dead single-celled organisms to kind of cleanse up a little bit. The white portions of the feces is the uric acid, which all birds produce as the uric waste. Camouflage. The ptarmigan is extremely well camouflaged. It's almost impossible to see it when it's hiding like this. This is a picture of the willow ptarmigan lying on eggs, which is also camouflaged, of course. And you can actually step on the bird before it moves. So it's if you see a bird like this, which is pressing itself down to the ground, you can actually take as many pictures as you want, and you can go as close as you want. You can almost touch it, because it will rely completely on its camouflage. And on this picture, you can see why. When it closes its eye, it's impossible to see. So that's a challenge for hunting. I will come back to that. The rock ptarmigan is more gray because it lives in rock areas and is also almost looking like a rock. In this case, it's only the neck which exposes the bird for the hunter or the photographer in this case. During winter, they are white, and of course, because it's they're living in snow areas, so they camouflage in the snow. What is interesting is that it is the amount of hours of light during the day which controls the color of the feathers. So if I take a white ptarmigan inside the room and put on the light 24 hours each day, mimicking the light of summer, it will change its fur to brown if it's a willow ptarmigan, or gray if it's a rock ptarmigan. So in the same fashion, you can take a completely brown willow ptarmigan and put it into a dark room and simulate light during winter with very few hours of light, let's say 2 hours of dim light. It will change its color of the fur or the feathers back to white. And they also go down and hide under the snow. This is a picture in the middle here. You can see here a bird in the snow, and here it has come up of its hide under the snow. You can see the marks of the wings here And on the right side, you see how this happens. The bird lands on the ground, digs down, and makes a snow cave. And in this snow cave, it will keep the heat very well and not get exposed to wind and not get exposed to predators. It hides. And if you come going, if you walk along along here, it can suddenly a bird is coming off from the snow and flying away. And of course, you are very not scared, but you are taken by surprise. So this is very common. And they also there's always a lot of feces in these holes because that will help them keep the heat. a little bit about willow and rock ptarmigan populations. We have seen in the last years a decline in the populations. This graph shows you the numbers of ptarmigans shot in Norway in the period from 1991 to 2013. And you can see that during the best years in 1999-2000, almost 550,000 birds were actually shot in Norway, meaning that the population is several million altogether. And this is just numbers that has been registered. Probably the numbers are much higher, but all hunters in Norway have to, of course, buy a license, and they have to report how many birds they have shot. And there are limitations on varying a little bit from area to area how many birds you can shoot. During good years, when you have high populations, you might shoot 5 or 6 birds a day per license. During bad years, you might only get allowed to shoot maybe 2 birds. But in the last years, the population has been going down, both in the rock ptarmigan and in the willow ptarmigan. So in 2013, there were only shot 150,000 birds. So this is actually something that the Norwegian government has noticed, of course, and they are now putting the ptarmigan temporarily on the red list, actually. So there are something going on, and we don't know exactly what it is. It could be climate change. It could be unfortunate incidents the last years with bad weather and cold weather or dry weather. So there's going on a lot of research on this now in Norway to find out why the decline in populations are happening. We know that it's not hunting because the numbers of birds that are shot is very small compared to the populations, and also usually the mortality in the autumn is high for the young chicks. They will probably not survive. Many of them will probably not survive their first winter anyway. So there are strong indications that hunting is not affecting the populations. It's something else. So that is something that we take very seriously, and we do a lot of research on that. If we look at factors that affect the ptarmigan population, you have a chick from the willow ptarmigan up here. This is a lemming, and this is a rock ptarmigan chick, and this is just a hunter going high up in the mountain. So factors that affect the ptarmigan population, of course, predators, fox, crow, raven, eagle, parasites. There are signs that parasites that they have inside in their intestines, but also in the skin, on the skin, is can regulate the population, affect the numbers. Availability of other prey, for instance, lemmings and mice. I will explain that. If you have a high lemming population 1 year, if the population is very high, these populations of lemmings and mice, they cycle very much. They are high some years and low other years. if the population of lemmings are very high, then the predators will easily catch the lemmings, and they will prioritize to take these animals instead of the chicks, meaning that the predator pressure on the ptarmigan is going down because they're so easy to get other food. So that's important. We see that when the lemming populations are low, more chicks are taken, and this will affect the population. Because remember that an eagle or a raven living high up in the mountain, they take catch a ptarmigan every second or third day. So they have an impact on the population. Then, of course, temperature and weather around hatching is very important during the hatching period and early chick development. I didn't say that, but in North Norway or Norway, the ptarmigans lay their eggs in May, June, July, and then the chicks are hatched 2 weeks later, and the condition the chicks are in during the August and September period, the hunt starts at 10th of September every year. Then this is very important, and during this period temperature and weather is important. So we have seen some correlation between very bad weather, cold weather during the chick period, and the number of birds that will actually counted or shot the following autumn. Water and food availability for chicks, especially insects, which again is weather dependent. If you have warm, moist weather, you have more insects. So this is linked. The problem with the ptarmigan population, and to explain the ups and downs of the ptarmigan population in Norway, is that there are so many factors involved. This is ecology. So the answer to this could easily come from a person, just a normal guy or a woman in the street, than a researcher. It's very many factors involved. Timing of snow disappearance is important, especially for the rock ptarmigan, which lives high up in the mountain. If there is a lot of snow and it takes a long time to get rid of it or to melt it 1 year, this could affect when they lay eggs, and also how big the chicks are and how well they are fed when the winter and autumn comes, because that's the critical part for the chicks the first year. Condition of the hen before egg laying. She can lay from 4 to 12 eggs, and in good times when she lays 12 eggs and maybe get 9-10 chicks that survive, you have, of course, a possibility of an exponential increase in the population the following year. During bad years, maybe the condition of the hen is not so good. She lay only 4 eggs, and then probably she will just substitute herself, actually. And there has been some indications that hunting might have something to say in certain areas when the populations are very low, but this is counteracted by putting either a ban that you cannot hunt in this area, or you're only allowed to shoot one bird. So this is very well regulated in most areas in Norway. Traditions in Norway. This is just some old pictures. You can see this guy. He has shot a lot of ptarmigans, and this is a picture from early 19th century. Also, people when they were looking after the cows when they were eating high up in the mountain, they could shoot ptarmigans, and they was seen upon as an additional meat source to get some more meat. So this is a hunting team going out. The Sami people hunt traditionally for ptarmigans with using these snares, which they put out between the where they know that the ptarmigan walks around to eat, and then the neck is trapped in this round the snare, and which is then strengthened when it goes further and the bird is suffocated. In Norway, we take our kids out for a ptarmigan hunt from very young age. This boy on the right side is, I think it's 8 years when he went for his first trip. And on the left side, you have a 12-year-old, which has shot his first ptarmigan. So the tradition is strong, and we take our kids out to hunt with us. And in this way, we kind of give this tradition very good opportunities to survive. That's very normal in Norway. Some pictures. This is from the kind of, this is the big ocean. So if you just continue out here, you will come to Greenland. So this is, I'm sure that you can understand why it's so nice to be hunting for ptarmigans, especially during days like this. We also do it during winter, then either on skis or in this case, you can take off the skis because the snow was blown away. We go ptarmigan hunting all year around, but the season goes from 10th of September to 15th of March the following year. This is also in north of Norway, Troms County, on the inland part. We use dogs. I will come back to that because dogs, they smell the ptarmigan. This is a typical ptarmigan dog. She has a satellite tracker around the neck, so that you get actually a message when she is standing still, meaning that she is seeing or smelling ptarmigan, and you can look at your monitor and find the dog and then hunt. Of course, this also helps you finding the dog if something happens to it, because if you go in steep areas, some dogs can fall down and break legs or get killed. So this is a new technology which is used in a ptarmigan hunt. This is a picture from high up in the mountain where we put up the tents, and we are there for maybe 2-3 days with a lot of good food, books, and hunting every day. And in this area, we can just go out of the tent and then start the hunt. So it's kind of a very social activity in Norway. This is my son, which has shot his two first ptarmigans. And of course, you get tired when your father wants to get you up at 5 o'clock in the morning. I cannot understand why we should start so early, but it's important to start early because the ptarmigan, they eat very early in the day. So we get them when they are eating, and then we have to, it's easier, more easy to find them then. But you get tired, of course. Okay, let's go over to the hunt, a little bit more about how we do it. This is a typical example of a standing setter, which is a dog which is trained to smell birds, ptarmigans, and when the intensity of the smell is above a certain level, then the dog knows that here a bird is sitting. And then it's standing like this, taking the right leg up. And this is a sign for the hunter that, okay, and the tail is stiff, going back. This is dogs that are, this use of this dog started in England. But anyway, then the hunter knows that in front of the nose of the dog, 2 meters, 4 meters, 5 meters, there are some ptarmigans. So get ready, get up behind the dog, get ready to shoot. So either you hunt with a dog, or you hunt without a dog. This setter, actually 25% of the brain is only focused on smell. And they are, of course, bred to react to the smell of ptarmigans and other some other birds. So they are extremely qualified, extremely well easy to use when you to find the ptarmigans, because that's your first problem, to find them. So I have put up some differences, or if you hunt with a dog or if you hunt without a dog. If you hunt with a dog, it's more relaxing because you can go around with your shotgun on your shoulder and look at the dog and wait for it to take a stand, as you saw the last picture. It's easier to find the birds, and the dog will find the birds for you because it runs around at 200-300 meters away from you, smelling up and down, back and forth, to get the right wind and to search in all the different areas. It's easier to hit the birds because you are told when there is ptarmigans and you can get ready. You have a nice cooperation between man and dog, which is someone likes a lot, of course, and they get a dog. So that's something that is nice. It's more easy to find the wounded birds, because if birds are wounded and not dead, they go hiding. And then, as you saw from the camouflage pictures, it's difficult to see them, so the dog will find it immediately. Of course, then you have a companion if you go on your own, but or with the dog, then you have a companion. And you can also train this and go for competitions with other dogs, and you can get, of course, a champion dog. If you are without a dog, which is how I hunt, then you have to read the terrain, you have to know the terrain, you have to say, okay, I think it's ptarmigans in that area, but not in that area. And so you have to plan a little bit more. You have to trust yourself and your knowledge. You have to be more observant of leads, tracks, signs, sounds. If you see feathers on the ground, if you see feces on the ground, that's tracks, signs. If you hear birds up in the mountain that talk to each other, that's sounds. So you are more observant when you hunt without a dog. And you're also more observant of other animals because you look for ptarmigans all the time. And so you are very concentrated. That will lead you to see other animals as well, more than if you have a dog. And of course, it's very challenging when these birds suddenly fly up in front of you, because you cannot smell them or see them yourself. Of course, sometimes you see them on the ground, especially that's more easy for the rock ptarmigans, and you can sneak up to hunt them. But very often they just suddenly fly up in front of you and you have to be ready. So it's much more challenging when it comes to shooting. You have to be quick and ready at all times. You have to find the wounded birds by yourself. And sometimes I've used up to 45 minutes just to find one wounded bird. Of course, you could be social with friends. Sometimes you can go on your own, but it's nice to have a friend with you. And of course, you have at the end the satisfaction of being your own hunter, that you did this on your own without the help of a dog, and you got up to the mountain, you got the food or the birds, and you got down. I will show you first a video that illustrates how it is to go hunting with a dog. See one hunter down to the right, and you see the dog running around searching for ptarmigans there. Comes back, take another search another way, takes a stand. Now there's the bird, and it's shot. And then afterwards, the dog will find the bird and come back to the owner with the bird. It's flying up, shot, falls down, this bird is dead, And then the dog runs over, catches the bird, and comes back to the hunter with it. So it's more relaxing, it's more and now he's of course telling the dog how good the dog is. I will show you a movie which I taken, which is without the dog. And then I know that in this area in front of me, I've seen birds before. I saw two birds that flew up when I came a little bit higher, and I'm going now down back again to see if there are more birds sitting between these rocks. And this is rock ptarmigan. So it's impossible to see it if it's hide in between the rocks. So I have to go very slowly, take it very easy to try to scare it up. So I just go down here, stop a little bit now and then, and wait. I have to be ready now. I have to be very concentrated, ready to shoot at any second. I have only one chance. But probably there are at least one, maybe several birds sitting here and try to hide. So if I will go back and forth here several times, maybe use 5-10 minutes here. I stop a little bit. The bird will come up now very soon. Stop. Look up. There it comes. So you have to be patient. You have to just take it easy. Take your time. And now I'm ready for another bird. If another bird comes up, I'm ready, because it could be more. It was sitting there, and I'm looking for maybe another one is coming. I knew that this bird was shot dead. I could see that, how it fell. So it's not a stress to go and pick it up. But in this time, I don't think anything more happened. But we can wait until we see how the bird landed. There's the bird, yes. Here. Oh, sorry. This is a film with my son. This is not a very nice weather day. It's a foggy. So when it's foggy and the bad sight, we have yellow signs on us to easily be seen. In this case, we have seen some ptarmigans up here, and we are I'm guiding my son into the birds. It's difficult to see them. I have binoculars. I will come back to what we take with us on the hunt, but I have binoculars, and I'm guiding him in. And this is actually a very special situation, because this is the time where one of my sons shot his first ptarmigan. And there I put up the binoculars. I look at the birds on the ground so I can see them and guide him in. He's sneaking now. Going down and sneaking to get close as possible to the birds. It's very exciting for a young man, very exciting. It's much better than a video game. Still, now it's very close. Guiding him. I hope you have sound, because you will hear some shots. when he gets his first ptarmigan. It's a very special moment. There, he got his first ptarmigan. Yeah, this is another situation. It's a very happy young man. Got his, I think this is maybe later, and this is his brother. Of course, you have to talk to these young guys or girls about life, about death, about how food is actually where we get our food from. Usually in the old days we hunted to get the food, now we produce the food, pigs, cows, whatever. So animals have to die if you want to get food. So this is a kind of a philosophical discussion that you have with the kids, which is actually very nice to have. And I've had all these philosophical discussions with all my sons when they are at his age. The movie on the right side shows you a very special special situation where all the ptarmigans had changed the fur feathers to white because the amount of light during the day, as I told you, it was autumn, so they the light runs or decides when they should change their fur, but there were no snow. The snow hadn't arrived yet. So in this mountainside, you see a lot of ptarmigans. All of these white spots are ptarmigans, and they will aggregate together when they are white and the camouflage is very bad because there is no snow there. So in this side, I think it was almost 2,000 ptarmigans during this day. Okay, what to bring on the hunt? Backpack, very important, where you put all your stuff in, and you have these wraps are very well, they're made for the shotgun, so they're thin. Food, snacks, of course, coffee, camping stove, survival equipment. This is an example of that. This is a sack which is lined with a silvery color, which so that the heat is conserved inside the sack. So this sack is used for camouflage if you hunt for reindeer, for instance. So you can see that when the person is inside the sack, it looks like a rock, but it's very warm. So if you have bad weather, if you are lost, you can go into the sack and keep the heat for several days. But then you also have these orange flags which you put out so that you can be seen from a helicopter or from other people. Binoculars, very important. Camera, maybe, if you should bring a big camera or a small camera, it's nice to have some pictures from the trip. Tape, rope, and tools to fix the shotgun or fix the sack, backpack, whatever. Bottle, water, map, phone, extra clothes, cap, mittens, hearing protection. This is active hearing protection, which actually increases the your hearing by what you call it, increasing the, well, you put on sound and then you hear very good. But when the shot comes from the shotgun, it's closed out. You don't hear the shot from the shotgun because it's so quick and loud. So it's active hearing protection. Headlight, if you have to, if you're lost and you, or you come down very late and you have to see. Hunting license, of course, ammunition, and a gun. Okay, we come to the food. You're back home from the hunt. You have ptarmigans in the sack and you want to eat dinner. This is the flying muscle or the breast of the bird, which is the, well, ptarmigans haven't said that, but it's a chicken bird. But you can see the it's very dark meat because it has a lot of myoglobin in the muscle. Because it's a chicken bird, which you know that chickens are not very good at flying, but the ptarmigans are very good at flying. They can fly very quickly and also for pretty long distances. And so they have a lot of myoglobin stored in the muscle cells, which is a molecule that stores oxygen. And this molecule, myoglobin, is dark in color, and that's why the meat gets dark. The chicken meat has no myoglobin, that's why the chicken meat is white. And we cut out these breasts and we fry them in the pan. And they're very soft, very delicate, very good food. And then we can look like this when you cut them out. And we also take the thighs, and this is the heart, which we use for the sauce maybe. And then you can serve food. It's a delicacy and highly priced, of course, if you go to a restaurant and order it there, because it has to be hunted. And of course, you need some wine for it. So there's a lot of different ways to serve the ptarmigan. You can also make a soup. Actually, this soup takes 20 hours to make because you fry it with a lot of vegetables and you put it in the stove for overnight. And then you have a concentrate, which you work further on the next day. And this soup is also very, very good. So then you have, of course, with your companions, with your friends, or you invite people, you have a social happening every year when the hunt is over, to eat ptarmigans and to celebrate the hunt.